Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live talk show dedicated to retouching and post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you for being part of our live audience today. In just a few minutes, we'll be speaking with Dennis Dunbar about practical blend modes, but first I have a couple of announcements. First of all, let me show you how you can interact with us today. You should see a panel that says questions here. If you don't see this lower portion, just click on the little arrow here, or it might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. This should drop down. You type your question or comment in here, and don't forget to hit send. Nothing happens unless you hit send. Feel free to pepper us with questions and comments throughout the program. I will incorporate them into the presentation if appropriate, and otherwise we will take some time at the end to catch up on any unanswered questions and to open the floor to any general questions. I want to remind everybody that Retouch Pro Live is brought to you through the generosity of our patrons. If you like Retouch Pro Live, if you want Retouch Pro Live to continue, the only way to guarantee that is to become a patron. Go to retouchpro.com/patron. I'm pasting that link in right now so you can bookmark it for later. You do need to be a registered to see all the benefits, etc. here on this page, but that's a double win for you guys because that also means that you will be invited to all future live shows as well. So please become a patron today. Okay. Dennis Dunbar is a Los Angeles-based compositor, retoucher, and author specializing in advertising and entertainment. You've seen his work on movie posters for movies like Star Trek, Harry Potter, and X-Men. Give me a second here, and I will switch over so that we can see Dennis's screen. There we go. Welcome back, Dennis.
Hello. How are you doing?
Real good. How about yourself?
Doing well. Doing well. It's a nice Saturday morning in September here.
Isn't it wonderful out? This is just the greatest time to be sitting back and learning about Photoshop.
Exactly. Anytime's a good time for that, huh?
That's, well, you know, I have an unusual idea of recreation. want to let everybody know before we get into the thick of things that this is like our fifth or sixth show with Dennis. And we might zoom by some points because we've covered them in depth in a previous show. So I want to invite everybody afterwards to go to YouTube and check out our previous shows with Dennis. You can go to youtube.com/retouchpro, or I'm also pasting in a link right now to a Dennis Dunbar specific playlist that I've built that only has the previous shows we've done with Dennis Dunbar, which will, like I say, we might reference some of those techniques today in passing, and rather than going off on a 20-minute tangent explaining something, we'll just, you know, say we talked about this two shows ago or whatever, and you can look at those there. So youtube.com/retouchpro, or use the longer, more complicated playlist link that I just pasted in. And do me a favor, subscribe to our channel while you're there. Okay, so practical blending modes, as opposed to theoretical or in general practical, how are we going to proceed today?
Well, I thought the first thing to do is give a brief overview of blending modes. So I'm sure people are familiar with the whole concept, so I don't want to get too deep into them. Want to focus on the practical aspect as opposed to the more esoteric side of things. But you know, with blending modes, if you have any particular layer, let's turn this layer on, you have all these different blending mode things that you can have that affect the way that layer interacts with all the other layers. Mm-hmm. And generally, they're grouped into sections here that you can see that kind of give you a basic idea of what this group does. So this group here starts off with darken. They all tend to darken the image in some way. Lighten, all these ones tend to lighten the image in some way. These overlay here, these are really useful things. They all tend to change the contrast of the image in some way. So 50% gray will be neutral, as in have no effect, and then whatever is lighter than 50% gray will lighten the image, and whatever is darker than 50% gray will darken the image. These get into a little more esoteric kind of things. If we have time, we might go into a little bit about the use of this. Of these, the one that I use frequently is difference. I use that when I'm compositing images together, and I want to make sure I got one thing lined up perfectly with another. Mm-hmm. Difference is really useful for that. And then these are also be used a lot. Hue, saturation, color, they're all affecting the color of the image in some way. And luminosity only affects the grayscale values,
okay,
the contrast or the brightness, darkness of the image for that.
Hopefully our audience will be at least passingly familiar with these, because if they aren't, they might get a little bit lost in the proceedings today.
Right, right. But hopefully we'll show them in a way that even people aren't that familiar with them are going to pick it up. So with that, I picked, for some of the workshops I teach, when we're talking about this, I thought it would be really useful to show people, give people a really clear idea of just exactly what's going on with these different blending modes. So my goal with this image was I took three different kinds of images, something with dark and detail, something, you know, bright. This is an older picture of my daughter, Katie.
She's adorable.
Thank you. She's now a high school senior, so I just hope she doesn't walk in while I'm showing this. But anyway, I put this together just because it would be a range of different kind of looking images for that, so we could kind of see how things work. And when you're working on retouching or compositing or whatever like that, one of the blending modes that's used the most is this overlay blending mode. So what I did with this image was, you can see by the layer masks here, I took and basically divided the image across so that there's upper half is controlled by one layer and the lower half is controlled by the other layer.
Okay.
So this one here, I turn this on, you see our contrast gets a lot stronger. This layer up here is a curve adjustment layer, and you can see there's no change to this at all. So it's just using the overlay blending mode. This one has no change, it's just using the overlay blending mode. This curve is on normal blending, and I adjusted this curve until I could no longer see the border.
Okay.
So I was calculating out just what is happening with this overlay. And this is the kind of math that's going on with the overlay blending mode.
So basically, you've built a curve that simulates what the overlay blend mode actually is doing.
Exactly. So people can see, like, oh, overlay blending mode is just changing contrast. And any kind of curve that has a shape like this is called an S-curve,
mm-hmm.
and that's going to increase your contrast. You're lightening the lighter values, and you're darkening the shadow values, the darker values. So you're increasing the contrast of the image for that. So that's just exactly what's going on here with the overlay blending mode. So if you turn this on and you go, oh, wow, this is really cool, but what's really going on? This is what's going on. You're just
adding... Can you toggle one or the other of those layers so that we can drive this point home? Half the image,
yeah.
The top half is is no curve, just simply with the overlay mode. The bottom,
yeah, a curve with no adjustment,
yeah,
just the overlay blending mode.
And the bottom is normal mode.
Yeah, the bottom is normal mode with an adjustment to it so people can see just exactly what's going on.
Cool. Excellent.
So you can see the difference in the contrast between top to bottom here. It's quite dramatic. Now, whether or not you want to add that much contrast to another image, to your image, is entirely based on the kind of effect you're getting. And you can always slide opacity down for this to lighten the effect.
Sure.
So, but this is basically just what's going on with this. So the next one that people use a lot is soft light. And soft light basically is just a gentler version of overlay. So if we come over here and click on this, you see this is, I don't have this one adjusted quite right because the middle point should be right going through there.
Okay.
But you see, this is basically just what's going on. It's just a gentler S-curve, not having as strong of an effect for this. And this reminds me, one of the things that you'll see happen a lot is, like with this image, let's say we want to increase the contrast of this image, so we'll merge all the layers for this image into a copy, and we'll put that one on overlay blending or soft light blending to get the effect. And the point that I want to make to people here is that an adjustment layer with no adjustment in it will give you the exact same effect as merging everything into a copy, into a layer in the copy, and putting that layer on the blending mode.
Okay, so an adjustment layer with nothing done to it and a blend mode applied is the same thing as applying it to a merged copy of everything below it.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. It's the exact same thing. And the benefit for using an adjustment layer, this could be any adjustment layer. It could be curves, levels, hue saturation, whatever. Any adjustment layer will give you the same effect. I like curves a lot. I use them an awful lot in what I do. But you could use anything. The advantage with doing this is the adjustment layer adds almost no overhead. Pardon me. The adjustment layer adds almost no overhead to your file. It doesn't increase the size of your file to any great extent.
Okay.
The other thing that's cool is if I had merged all this stuff and put into it, and I go, now you know what? These highlight things are sticking out, and I want to tone those down. If I go to the layers underneath and retouch them out, then I have to remake my merged layer and
sure.
do that. If I do this with an adjustment layer, then like, hey, I can just do the retouching underneath it, and I won't have to remake anything.
But now, does this technique that you're talking about using a null adjustment layer, is that only for the contrast blend modes?
No, it's for everything. It's for everything. This is screen. This is what's going on with screen. So if you check here, screen is basically just lightening your image, just pulling the curve up like this. But it would be the same thing for that. This one is multiply. And this is what's going on with multiply. It's just pulling it all down.
We did a show just last weekend about Photoshop experiments, which was techniques that you could do just to illustrate to yourself and drive home what Photoshop is doing behind the scenes. This that you have right here is an excellent example of a Photoshop experiment. You've got you fiddle with the curve until it matches, and you can look at that curve, and so you will now have a deeper understanding of what multiply does, etc.
Yeah, exactly. With multiplying with screen, we multiply, the darker the image, the stronger the effect. So white will have no effect in multiply blending mode. Black will have the maximum effect. With screen, it's the opposite. Black will have no effect, and white will have the strongest effect. So so you see, that's why it emphasizes the shadows coming down here. And with screen, it emphasizes the highlights up here more.
Okay.
But that gives people a pretty good idea of just what's going on with this. In terms of a practical use for this, here's an adjustment layer, just a pattern I made. Just added some texture to a neutral gray layer. And if I put this on, say, overlay blending, you see now this is a way of adding an interesting texture. It looks a little bit like rain falling or something like that.
And we'll point out to everybody that everything that's gray in that, it disappears completely, which is a commonality of all the contrast mode blending.
Yeah, all the overlays, soft light, all these things. I'd have to double check it with thin light and hard mix. I hardly ever use these things. But I know definitely with all these, 50% gray has no effect. So it's a very common technique. People will make a layer, fill 50% gray, add some texture to it or something like that, and then only the lights and darks are showing up. You're not affecting the midpoint thing. The other thing that's really cool about this overlay blending mode is that it will protect the extreme highlights and the extreme shadows of your image. So if we zoom in here, you see where it's casting light all across here. It's actually kind of an interesting effect in here. But it's not affecting our shadows at all. So our shadows aren't the blacks here are not getting that in the any effect in here, and the whites here aren't getting darkened up by anything either.
Okay.
For that. So the advantage with that is one thing that's really common is people will make a layer and add noise to it. So if I set this up to overlay blending till it fits, though it fits 50% gray. If I zoom in here and now go to my noise filter, add noise, if we really crank this up so it's the extreme, you see the noise isn't messing up the shadows. It's kind of protecting the highlights. We don't have any strong highlights in here.
Okay.
It's not dirtying up the whites. It's not dirtying up the blacks. If you were to just add noise to a merged layer, you'd get white specks in here and black specks in here, which wouldn't look quite right.
Excellent.
Yeah, so that hopefully this gives people a good idea of what's going on with that one. The next thing I wanted to show in practical terms was, let's go to this image here. This is something that we talked about in a previous thing.
I'll point everybody to YouTube to watch your detailed show about how you put this poster together.
Right. The thing I wanted to talk about here was all these different lightning layers here. All this lightning that's get added in here, these are all using blending modes. So if we just duplicate this to a new layer, to a new image, and turn off the layer mask, you see what we have here is this is a stock shot of lightning.
Oh, okay.
The art director had. By using the screen blending mode, if we force this area here to black, the only thing that's going to show up are the areas that are lighter than that. So it's going to kind of give us the effect of a nice glowing bit of lightning.
So basically the tones inherent in the actual image do your masking for you.
Exactly. If I set this to normal, you see this is all the stuff's going on. Now I have a curve adjustment layer here set clip to this, because the idea with that was to force the dark areas to being black. And this was, I used the black sampler, the black eyedropper, and clicked on there to force this area to be black, because I didn't want all this other area to show up here. If we set this back to screen, and I turn this off, you see how it has much more of an effect here, brightening all this stuff here. So that was one thing to keep in mind if you're using screen blending mode, is you may need to add an adjustment layer, something like that, to force the black stuff or the dark stuff you don't want showing up, force it to black so it's just limiting the effect to the very lightest areas that you want.
And don't forget to clip your adjustment layer.
Right. Yeah, clip the adjustment layer for that, because if you don't clip the adjustment layer, you don't have this little bent arrow, then it's going to affect the entire image.
Yeah.
And not give you the effect.
That's not bad. That looks like the sequel poster.
Yeah. And then other ways of using textures or using layers are like this. This is, I'm going to duplicate this again to a new layer, duplicate layer to a new thing, slide the opacity all the way up. This is just some rusty looking texture stuff the designer Tomash added into this. And so by putting this on overlay blending, it's just providing some textural look to the thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that's another way of doing that. Tomash thought just a little hint of texture kind of gave it some nice rough feel. He had a couple of things here layered in. This one has very little effect. He also did a move where he merged certain parts of the image together, and then did a blur on it. So then by doing that, it just gets this sort of a little soft light kind of thing going on, and it has another layer for that.
A couple of subtle effects, but a couple of effects that separate the high-paid Hollywood stuff from the rest of us.
Right, and these are very common ways that they're being used for this. So we're using blending modes, so we can control what shows up where, and we don't have to make really sophisticated masks. If you look at the mask for this thing, it's very sloppy, but it doesn't have to be really sharp because we're using a blending mode to control that. It saves a huge amount of effort when you're doing something like blending in this, and then we're just adding texture with these other layers for this. Another thing we wanted to show was, like, here's something which is a more normal kind of composite. I think we've talked about this in the compositing show for that. And you see all these layers here that are marked with green are using blending modes for this stuff. So there's all kinds of stuff
going
on
here. Now, you did that for us, or is this something that you normally do for yourself?
I marked them with green for this show.
Ah, okay. So that's
so
not
that
a,
way
that's
I don't
not
have
a
to go
dip.
back and look for each one thing. It's not a normal habit I have for it. One of the things that especially if you're working on a professional level where you're going to be sharing files or somebody else is going to see your layered files, it's very important to always make sure you name your layers for this so you can see the all the layers have names, give you an idea about
You
exactly
even
what's
named your
happening.
adjustment layers, which I know a lot of people skip.
I name the adjustment layers so that I can remember just exactly what they're for. Now these, I'm using, this is a color adjustment layer. This is a curves adjustment layer. You can see, add a little bit of color effect here. And this is using the color blending mode. So this curves layer is only going to affect the color of the girl. It's not going to affect the lightness or the darkness or the contrast of her. And this luminosity one, this is only going to affect the darkness and lightness, the contrast. So I'm darkening her up with this one. If we come up here and turn off all these layers here, you get an idea. This is the way she was shot. Now these are all the retouching layers. We don't want to go through all that stuff, but you see the various layers for the retouching thing. And then one of the first moves he did was add some color correction, so warm her up a little bit. So that's what this is doing. It's adding a little bit of red, pulling a little blue out for her, so she's getting a little warmer. This was a similar kind of thing, a little bit stronger, and this is just to kind of provide some warmth to her arms. You can see the
okay.
mask for that. So that's basically just kind of helping fit her into the background. The very warm colors in the background, we're just teasing a bit more into the edges there.
I do like seeing how your masks, in spite of your reputation as one of the best compositors in the industry, your masks still look kind of clumsy like mine.
Well, the accuracy of your mask all depends on what you're doing. You notice here that there's this little clipped arrow. This is part of a clipping group. So I can make this mask really sloppy because the clipping group thing ensures that this adjustment layer is only going to affect this layer down here that it's clipped to. So this is the accurate mask.
Okay.
This is the mask I didn't have to be accurate, and I could just sloppily brush around here. So I'm leveraging this mask. This is a very important aspect for compositing or any kind of retouching. I'm leveraging this mask by making all these things be clipping groups.
And again, I'll point everyone
to this mask
to
is controlling
YouTube shows.
Every single layer, every single one of these layers, all the way up to here.
I'll point everyone to our YouTube shows. For the more detailed discussion on how you build those nice masks that are much better than anything I do.
Yeah, exactly. And this thing was done a few years ago, so I'm always updating and changing my techniques. And it's interesting when I look at some of these images I've been using in workshops, like, wow, this is how far my techniques have evolved in the last few years, which is good. But this is still a file structure that I use a lot, and I recommend anybody take full advantage of clipping groups, layer groups, all these things, because it really gives you a lot of control over just what's showing up where.
And I also notice you have nested folders in there.
Yes, I have nested folders in here. This layer group, if we close it up, you can see we have foreground, which is this. These are affecting everything in the image. And then I have girl, and then I merged all this stuff for the background because for the purposes of these demos and stuff, people didn't need to see all the ways I retouched the background and added, layered in different blurs and stuff, so we teased in more of a
sense of
depth
of field. So the real
version
was even much more complicated than the one, or much more complex than the one you're showing us here today.
Right, exactly. So this adjustment layer here is a curves adjustment layer, and it's set for luminosity blending. So you see it's darkening her up a bit. If I set this to normal blending, we should see the color changes. See, she gets a little more red.
Yeah.
And that's why this is my divide and conquer technique, where I use one curve adjustment layer set for color blending and one set for luminosity blending.
Now,
it makes it a lot simpler for me.
You mentioned in one of our previous shows that you never just add a curves layer. You always add two.
Well, 95% of the time, I'm always using two, one for color blending and one for luminosity blending. The idea with that is if I want to darken her up, I can, without affecting her color, I can do that really easily. But if I darken her up and then now she gets too red, now I have to come over to red and pull some red out and I have to do that and I wind up chasing my tail running around. And I think that's one of the reasons why people find curves so hard to learn.
Mm-hmm.
Is because, like, I just want to make this thing darker, but now it gets too red. What's going on? I have to pull some red out, but now it's not dark enough because I've changed this, or it's too dark and I've changed that. So this simplifies the whole factor.
So you just add one with luminosity mode and one with color mode.
Right.
Do you do that with all the other adjustment layers as well, or just curves?
I use curves for like 95-98% of
okay,
all the color curves.
It doesn't come up. You mostly use curves, and so you mostly do this.
Right. Now, and one of the other things that I think we'll show, there is a twist. About a year and a half ago or so, I learned a technique for working with multiply blending that uses a hue saturation adjustment layer for that. So I think we can show that a little bit later in the thing, but I want to continue on this thing. So this one here is just darkening your hands, and this was only a little bit of darkening, and you see I added some warmth here, but this is a normal blending. So I didn't use it universally for everything. I just needed to darken her hands, and it looks like, oh, now they need a little warmer. So it's really easy to do this minor adjustment here. And this one here is adjustment layer set for multiply blending. So there's no change here.
So that's what you were talking about earlier. It's just adding it's the same thing as multiplying a merged copy.
Right. And that's just darkening this area in here. Now, the real advantage for this is as I darken this, if I realize like there's something here that needs to be retouched, I can come under here and retouch it with one of these things, and I don't have to change any of these things.
Okay.
And if I added this and like, oh, now I have to retouch on top of this, if I make changes to any of these here, my retouching on top won't fit anymore, and I'll have to remake it. So by using this kind of workflow, it makes it a lot easier to come in and make the adjustments you need. You don't have to run around in circles for this. So this one here, what I call highlight shaping, this is using overlay blending, and this is just a paint layer where I'm just painting white. So I'm just zooming in and painting white in these areas here with the idea of bringing more light in to make this look more like shiny satiny fabric. So
if you just if you just expose only that highlight shaping layer, will we be able to see the actual paint work you did on there?
You know what I think we can do is let's make a new layer. I'm going to fill a new layer with black, and if I set this to normal blending,
okay,
that's where the paint shows up.
So that's just basically exaggerating the highlights in those selected areas.
Exactly. It's just pushing more, brightening things up. And I did this with paint because it was just easy to go in, and I'm not a trained painter, illustrator, but this is sort of like, trying to think about that way. Like, where would, like, we'd want to tickle some light in around here for this, some light here, so... it's one of the things I use a lot in helping to enhance the lighting in that. And this is a modified technique, but retouchers do this a lot with burning and dodging.
I have seen that a lot, especially in beauty work, along the bridge of the nose and the cheeks and the forehead and like that.
Right. And we have a couple of beauty images. I think we can show off that thing here as well. So this layer here and this layer here, they're basically just doubling up. But this is a screen adjustment layer. And this is the idea with this is, see, I made a mask here. This mask was made by copying one of the channels and pushing that over. But this mask is controlling where it shows up. So the idea is just to Make a Mask is just giving me the highlights in the hair, and then I put that in screen blending, and then I pushed it even farther. So this is one of the things where it's really cool about using an adjustment layer, is if the normal strength isn't enough for you, you get all this control. You can push this up even more to strengthen the lightning thing. If it was multiply and you wanted to darken it, you could pull it down and push the darkening effect even stronger.
Okay.
So it gives you more power with this. If we had just taken her hair, merged it into a copy, and then put it on screen blending, I'd have to keep doubling to get the amount of lightning I want on that. And I would have a sack of, you know, like maybe 8 or 10 of these hair things. It may not give me the effect I want.
Okay, so it gives you the capability of turning it up to 11 if you need to.
Exactly, or even 15 if you want. Take that, rock and rollers. So this wasn't quite the amount of boost I wanted, so I added another layer for this. And so it's just a copy of the same layer for that. And then we have this one here. Screen blending, no change. This is brightening her eyes and little bits of her hair. So the primary effect I was looking for was to bring some light into her eyes.
Uh-huh.
And then I thought, oh, you know, a little more light on her hair, a little more drama coming into here. This is normal blending. So these two things here, this is just pushing the contrast. And then this is darkening, painting in and darkening some of the edges. And this mask looks really sloppy, but again, it's a clipping group.
Okay.
It's going all the way down here. See how many layers we wind up building up for this?
And this is after you simplified this for us.
This is after the simplifying. So this is multiply curves. This is set for 50% blending, and the idea here is just doing a little burning. So the way that I'm doing this now, that's a little bit different. It didn't show up in effect here that was a problem, so it didn't really notice it much. But sometimes when you're doing this, it will increase the saturation of the image a little bit. So the trick I learned from a retoucher friend was, I've just loaded this as a selection. Let me turn this off. I'm going to show you. By holding down the Option key and clicking on this thing, I can bring this up and I get this dialog box here.
Right.
So we'll call it burn/HS. And we'll put on multiply blending, say 50%. Now this is a cool thing. When you do this with a hue saturation layer, you can slide the saturation up or down. So if I don't like the saturation gain, I can just pull saturation down here, and it just provides a more neutral effect of darkening the burning the thing.
And so this is the way I do burning. Multiply, it doesn't have any unwanted color shifts?
Well, sometimes when you put an adjustment layer on multiply, you will get a color shift. So this is a way. It'll get more saturated and typically a little more red. So doing it with a hue saturation layer, it's one of the few times I use hue saturation, but doing that, I just get this saturation slider, so I can slide the effects really, you know, let's boost our effect up to 100%. And now we can see.
you see how
we get this control with the slider thing?
Okay.
So we can make, you know, 2D saturated, and it looks like she's got a beard. 2 saturated, and now it's jumping out. So you'd want to find the happy balance for that. And that's why 100% is usually a little too strong for these things. But that's the way I'm doing it now.
Excellent.
That's the way I'm doing that now. And then this thing, as you talked about burning and dodging, this is what you would call a dodge layer. In this case, I call it a glow layer. And this is on soft light, and this is just taking white paint and painting over here, all these things to try to give more modeling to the her body.
The same way that you did on her bustier earlier.
Yeah, exactly. And the whole idea with that is, if you think like a painter, dark values are going to recede into the background, light values are going to come forward. So shape, you could take a flat disc, just make it neutral gray and make a circle and fill it with flat gray and it looks flat. And then if you start to lighten the middle of it and darken the edges of it, it starts to look more like a three-dimensional ball.
Okay.
So that's all that we're trying to do here is bring a little more shape. It's also a way of, if you lighten these areas and darken these areas, you can kind of also fake a little bit of a slimming mode. Because when we're looking at images, the only clues we get about the shape are the darkness and lightness.
Okay.
So by emphasizing that, we're kind of helping to do this. So that's basically what burning and dodging is just doing for this. So this is again, another layer of that, adding a little bit more of that effect to it. And this is on normal blending. What?
You're using soft light mode for those highlight glow layers.
Right, soft light. Just because it's a little more gentle effect, and you see I have it turned down to like 60% here. This one's 100%. So it's a matter of you know, realizing like overlay was too strong, so I go to soft light because it's less intense of an effect, and then I can slide the opacity down. But if I had it 100%, if I wanted to really boost this up, I could set this to overlay blending, and like there. Now we pushed it even farther.
Ah, okay.
So knowing the blending modes gives you a lot of power with these things. Backing out a little bit, that's all the stuff for the girl. Here, this is a vignetting curves. So this is a curve adjustment layer set for multiply, and it's clipped to the table here. So it's just clipped to this. And so we're just kind of shadowing in here and focusing the light on her because her eyes will be drawn to the light and move away from the shadows. And then this is an overall color adjustment layer. So we're adjusting the color, making it like this. This is luminosity. We're adding a little hint of contrast, brightening it up a little bit. And these are the final touches.
So you really do use curves 95% of the time.
Yes. Yeah. This is, I think I wanted to push the res in her dress. So this is one of the few times I've experimented around, like, what if I did this and what if I draw that? So this is one of the few times I use selective color. Now, everybody has different ways of working. Some people use selective color for an awful lot of stuff. But for me, I rely primarily on curves for that. So let's see. This is another one we can just quickly take a look at.
Again, I'll point out that we covered this particular image in excruciating detail in another video that's up on YouTube. So I'll just point to everyone to that if they want to review some of the stuff in more detail.
Yeah, exactly. Here, and you see the way I'm doing this stuff. This is the horizon layer back here, and so this is a noise layer to add some noise into it. These are adjustment layers. This is just flat color, just painting color in there. This one is using luminosity, and it's just darkening. It's just adding some contrast back there, or no. Removing contrast. So this is pulling the white point down and lightening the black point. So that the idea with that was just as things recede into the very far distance, the ambient haze seems to remove contrast from the image. That's why you look at mountains and stuff in the far distance, and they always look kind of grayish or bluish, whatever.
Right.
It's just picking up the haze. So it's just doing things like that. This was the walkway here.
Mm-hmm.
And so these things are just adding some shading. They're on multiply blending, and it's just paint. One of the things we wanted to talk about, too, was in addition to layers having blending modes, layer groups can have blending modes. And you notice if I click on here, this layer group for the model, this guy here, is set for normal blending.
Okay.
The default blending mode is pass-through. The reason why I'm using normal blending for this is I had all these layers here, but since all these layers here are grouped to, these layers here are clipped to him, and then I had to add some hair work for it. So the idea with that is painting in little hairs around the edge to give it a more natural look. But if I clip that to here, then that whole effect goes away because it would wind up looking just like this. So I needed to have multiple layers in here. And then when it came to making an adjustment, like darkening the whole thing, I needed a way to do that. So I could either have this darken curve layer, where you see there's adjustment here, I could have this darken curve layer clipped to here and another one clipped to here and copies all over the place. Or I can take advantage of the fact that if I set this to normal blending, adjustment layers only affect the layers that are inside the layer group. They have no effect on what's going outside. So if I set this, if I zoom out a little bit, and I set this to pass through, which is the default, you see this darken curves is affecting everything.
Okay.
And so I'm leveraging that. So I don't use blending modes an awful lot with layer groups, but I do take advantage of this normal and pass through.
So
I only worry about it when I need to.
It's related to clipping in a theoretical sense, not in a literal sense.
Right. Now, the other thing you have to keep note is sometimes you can't get away with that. So if I – let's turn off this darken curve. Let's turn that one back on, and let's set this to pass through. So we have this set this way, and suppose we wanted to add noise into this thing. So here's a layer. This layer is just a layer of noise, like we just showed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's affecting everything in the image here because I didn't bother clipping it in. But when I have it on pass-through, this behaves exactly like we would expect a layer set for overlay blending to work. So we're just getting that contrast enhancement. If I set the blending mode on this to normal, it overrides this. And now,
oh, cool.
Whatever's outside the layer group, now we're getting this gray.
Huh.
So that's the one caveat with using normal blending. Is like if you're using some of this, then you'd have to like make copies and clip it or whatever. You have to get around it for that. And sometimes if you're merging things, if you're merging layers and stuff like that, every now and then you have a blending mode here and like, uh-oh, suddenly when I'm merging things, something acts differently. So then you have to go back and troubleshoot and figure that out.
Do you ever use any of the other blending modes on folders?
On occasion, but not often. Not often. I might have something where it's set for screen blending or color dodge. Color dodge is really great if you want to add like a bright burst of sunlight or something.
But it is this would never be part of your day-to-day workflow.
Yeah, in fact, I'd have to look for the layers in here. Lamp post, lighting. Oh, this is just overlay. So you see, this was just paint, yellow paint. Just letting here to make it look like this lamp post is a little bit, and that's using a blending mode. But if we set that to color dodge, it has a much stronger effect for that. So occasionally I use color dodge for something like that. And if I have several layers in that, it might be easier to set a blending mode for the layer group for it. But it's not very often.
Pascal wants to know, is there a difference between putting a layer group on normal mode or just putting a mask on the layer group?
It saves you the issue of having to add a mask for it. But yes, you could do it that way. In this particular case, I would have to merge this mask with this, because if I copied this mask up to the layer group, it would cut all the hair out. So then I'd have to, it makes it more complicated making a mask
okay.
here, because then I have to like, okay, how am I going to accomplish that? I could merge all these into a copy and then make the transparency on that, and then make the mask on that, and then toss my merged copy thing.
Plus, you'd be at the mercy of the quality of your mask.
Right, right. So in Photoshop, there's probably a dozen ways to accomplish any one thing. It's one of the things that makes it a lot of fun, and you know, the more you learn, the more you realize, like, hey, this one circumstance, that odd twist works. But I find using this normal blending mode, in this case, to be the simplest way of doing that, so I don't have to tackle that complicated thing. But if I did have something to it, sometimes you have to do it that way. If I had something in there that wasn't working, sometimes you just have to go ahead and make a complicated mask for your layer group. Let's see, what are the other things we wanted to share? Let's come over here and we talked about some beauty ones.
Right.
So let's open up this image. And
Catherine Thorbeck.
Yeah, she's a model. She's a model that a photographer friend of mine, Rick Rose, photographed for this. And since I didn't want to get into all the retouching layers and stuff like that for her, because we want to keep this focused on here. I merged all those into here.
We can always come back to it in a future show.
Yeah, yeah. So this is what the image looked like before, and then start adding in some other effects.
You say before, but you named it retouch. So there's been a bucket load of work that you've already done on that.
Right. This is what it looks like before I did all the adjustments
I just
enhancing
to
the color
the
and the contrast there. And stuff. This is basically just the retouched version of the thing. And you'll notice here, like, her face and her neck and chest have a little bit different color.
Yeah.
So here's a color adjustment layer. So for color blending, because I didn't want to make it lighter or darker. And, you know, since it was looking a little bit too magenta and red, added a touch of green and took a little bit of red out. When color correcting skin tone, the green magenta balance is the most important balance.
Okay.
Because if it's a little bit too green, people look a little sick. If it's a little bit too magenta, people look sunburned. So it's a very careful balance.
So
usually
whenever
it's
you're
like
making
a minute move.
Whenever you're making this particular adjustment, you are not putting a layer on there and then dragging it this way and that way and seeing what looks good. You actually know ahead of time which curves you will need to be looking at.
For the most part, I do drag it around and see the effect. And some, you know, normally, since green and magenta is such a careful balance for it, in fact, here, let's, what we're just talking about, I don't want to get too caught up in this, but
just let everybody know, the green curve and the magenta curve are the same curve, just different directions.
Right. I'm just going to show here, this is set for color blending, so if I add more red, that can, it looks a little too red, but that circumstances where that can be pleasing. I can take some blue out, and that can be pleasing. Add some blue, that can be kind of a pleasing look.
Mm-hmm.
But green, if I take this out, like, something looks kind of sick about her,
okay.
And we haven't added much green. And this way, now she's looking a little bit too sunburned.
60s Polaroid.
Yeah, and so I think it's because as human beings, we're hardwired to recognize what looks healthy. And whenever we see green people, they're sick. They've got the flu or something.
That's why
the
monsters are always green
people.
In the movies.
Right, and whenever we see magenta people, like, oh, you're sunburned. And we relate to the pain of the sunburn. That's just my amateur guess about it. But that's why I say the green magenta balance is so very important.
That's an excellent tip.
Yeah, so here this is, it's got a layer mask in here, and it's just brushing in here just so we bring that in. This is something where it doesn't have an adjustment, any thing for it, but it's just a light layer of paint on that. So it's something I do, you have to do very carefully. This is adding some shape to her forehead. And this is where I was using that hue saturation layer.
Ah, okay.
This is set for multiply blending. I call it burn because I'm doing a burning move. I had to take a lot of stray hairs out of here. And by the time I was done, I was thinking, like, that forehead looks a little bit too big. It looks a little too flat. So thinking like a painter, dark values recede. So I could brush in a little bit of darkening in here.
Okay.
And make it look like the crown of her forehead is here, not up here.
Excellent.
Make her forehead look a little smaller by doing this. And then this is glow, but this is soft light layer, and this is just paint adding in.
Okay, that's the technique we looked at a little earlier.
Like this is a dodging layer for that. This one here is using screen blending, and that was based on a copy of the blue layer, and then I use curves to push the shadow values up for this. And the idea with this layer was to bring in some highlights into her hair for this. So this is set for screen blending. This has that layer mask for it, so that's going to control where that is. And then I put that inside a layer group. Let's turn that off.
Okay.
I put that inside a layer group. This is not changing the blending mode, but this layer group has a mask here, so I can restrict that just to her hair. So after I went to all the work of making this mask, I can leverage that mask, and I can adjust that mask this way without affecting this. So for whatever reason, I thought, no, I like the effect over everything. I don't have to remake the mask. I just turn this on and off.
This has nothing to do with blending, but it just came to my mind, and I figured you'd be the man to ask this to. Is there a way, there's a way to merge the visible layers onto a new flattened version, okay?
Yes.
Is there a way to merge more than one layer mask into a new layer mask?
There is. I would use the calculations.
Ah, okay. All right. There's another show.
And here is calculations works only off what's in your channels mode. So you'd have to copy your layer mask, or if we bail out of this, if I click on this layer, then you see you get the mask showing up as a channel here.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd have to pull this down and copy that. And then you can come over here to calculations.
Okay.
And then you play around. And
so it is possible.
Blending modes and stuff.
Might
like
not
that.
Be practical, but it is possible.
Right. There's a older book, a very old book. I think the very first book written about Photoshop.
Channel Chop.
By David Biedney and Burt Monroy. Photoshop Chops or Channel Chops or something like that they call it.
Brilliant book. I still look at it once in a while.
Yeah, they went into great depth on all that, and I don't have a copy any longer. For a while there, they were selling for like $400 or $500 a piece, and I was freaking myself for not knowing what a copy was. But the information in there about using calculations, it was really deep, and it still applies to Photoshop today. And it's like 20, 25 years later.
If you'll pardon the plug here, I do have some videos up on our rental site that go into calculations in great detail. I'll paste the link in now if anybody's interested. We did that with a beauty retoucher named Chris Tarantino. We spent, I think there was like 6 or 9 hours of videos up there just tearing apart the various potential uses of calculations, etc. So I pasted that link in for the audience if they would like to review otherwise. But I am planning on doing a calculation show with you sometime in the future.
Interesting. I don't use calculations a whole lot anymore.
Okay. So this is new to you that I want to do a show about that.
Yeah, I used to use calculations a lot, like for making masks about hair and stuff.
I'll loan you my copy of the Channel Chops book beforehand.
Yeah. Oh, good. Good. Because when Photoshop came out with the Refine Edge tool, the Refine Mask tool,
yeah,
then that eliminated an awful lot of the, like, how do I capture these little stray hairs here?
I always forget about that. I mean, I use it virtually daily, but I always forget about the impact that it's like a line of before and after Refine Edge.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So this layer here is soft light, and this one is meant to add some contrast to the image, just a little bit of contrast. This is using basically the inverse of this. So you see here, and here we have blue copy and blue copy 2. So basically what I did was copy this, invert the values, and then use that as a mask. So I... It's primarily affecting the darks. Very little effect on the highlights, more effect on the darks. Just
can
to
you
kinda
turn that particular one up to 100% so we could see what it would look like?
Sure.
Huh. That's not bad even there.
Yeah, it's not. It gains a little bit of saturation, which is one of the things. It's a curve. So if I'm going to do that, I would switch this to the hue saturation thing and then pull the saturation down to an acceptable thing because she looks a little too saturated. That's kind of a nice effect. So it's one of the nice things about setting it this way is it's always your taste and it's enhanced, easily adjustable. And then here there's a noise layer, and that's set for overlay blending for that. So it's just adding a little bit of, let's see if we see the effect. Can you see the change?
Can you toggle it? Ah, okay.
Yeah. Now, one of the things I do a lot with noise layers is, you see this has a weird looking icon to it. It's actually a fill layer with it filled with a pattern, and I made a series of noise patterns for that. So it's kind of a twist on adding noise because I use these noise patterns for it.
Where did you get the patterns?
I made the patterns. I got the idea from a retoucher friend, a guy, Konstantin Golubchinsky. And Konstantin's now a antiques dealer. He got out of the retouching business. But Konstantin was a guy, he had like 150, 200 actions that he used all the time. And he showed me this noise pattern technique. And he had, here's one with 3% noise and a half pixel blur and embossing on this. And like, he had all this, he could remember it all.
But it's still mechanical noise generated by Photoshop. It is not like noise that you borrowed from a photograph or something like that.
Right, exactly. It's just basically what I did was I made a square image. I think 1,024 pixels by 1,024 pixels. That was what Konstantin said worked without seeing repeating patterns.
Mm-hmm.
And I filled it with 50% gray and added noise, added 1% noise, saved it as a pattern. Undid it, added 2% noise, saved it as a pattern.
Okay.
Go step by step.
And
you
name them very carefully.
Right, and you have to make different ones for RGB and for CMYK because 50% gray in RGB doesn't equate easily to 50% gray in CMYK.
And then you always apply these in overlay mode?
Sometimes soft light, but you see here are all the noise patterns I had. So the cool thing with this is if I decided this 4% noise wasn't enough, I could click on this one. And let's zoom in, and you see the difference. Oh, I have to click OK, and then you see the difference here. And all I had to do was double click it.
Okay.
Click on here and change that. Plus, you also get a scale factor, so you can scale it up. You can scale it down.
Okay.
So you get all kinds of control over this. It's really a very cool technique.
Now, do you usually finish up your images with a noise layer, or did this particular image simply call for it?
I typically add a small amount of noise to the top of images. Part of the thing is, I think for some reason, a small amount of noise just gives the eye something to latch onto, and so it kind of makes the image look a little sharper.
Hmm.
It also makes it look a little more organic, less computer-generated, I suppose. And it also is a great way of hiding any sort of thing. Like, so if you had to get in here and paint something and there was some noise in the original captured image and then your paint had no noise, it's a way of hiding the difference.
Okay.
So that's really where I learned the technique was working on movie posters. Because in the old days when you scan film, you may have 4x5 elements and then tightly cropped 35mm elements, and all that blown up really big, and you had to come up with some way of making it seem to have a consistent grain pattern. So the idea was you put a layer on top of it, add noise to it, and add just the right amount of noise, and everything would kind of blend in together. Oh, look, it has a uniform grain structure. I believe it now.
Okay, so it kind of pulls the room together, so to speak.
Right. And the difference between when we were working with scanned film, the noise amounts that would be typical for something like this might be 6 or 8% noise, maybe even 10% noise sometimes, and now it's like 2%, 3%, sometimes 4%.
Okay.
But sometimes 4% can, like, oh, that's really high. So now you're using a lot less noise, but it's still the same idea.
So this has nothing to do with preventing banding or any of the traditional reasons why we might want to add noise.
Right. It does help. It does help with hiding banding.
But that's not the reason you're doing this. Okay.
Yeah, I wasn't running into any banding with this image here. It was just kind of help as a finishing touch.
Excellent.
But, what else do we have in the
You have some more
here
to show us?
Yeah, we can.
Who's that movie star? We have anything interesting looking on that movie star looking one?
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can open this one up. There was some blending modes in that. This one was done with a photographer, Scott Nathan, and Digital Photo Pro or something like that was doing a retrospective of his work. So this was one of the images I worked on for him for that. So with this, you know, there's all these various retouching layers and stuff like that going on in here. But here's a curve adjustment layer for whitening your teeth, and that's set for color blending. So I'm not lightening or darkening your teeth. It was just, they looked a little too red.
Hmm.
Here's a burn layer. So this is what the mask for the burn layer looks like. And this burn layer is hue saturation, with the saturation pulled down. And the idea with that is, I don't know, it's very subtle. So it's hard to see the difference for that. And somewhere here, I also have a dodge. Oh, just dodge grips, but this is using normal blending. So this is a dodge layer.
Okay, so this is just skin texture and stuff you're working on here.
Right, and the dodge layer I just pulled it up a little bit, didn't cause any shift in the color or whatever, so I wasn't that worried about it, and that because it wasn't a very strong move, and the idea is just going in and trying to smooth out like little areas like this, so you know, make the surface of her cheeks and skin look a little more uniform and that. So that's what these particular layers are. This is dodging the edge of her irises. So this is paint on soft light blending. Just taking a little bit of white paint or a light color paint and just painting in like that. This is using screen blending. It's the same thing with the girl with the arms up. This was for her hair. So here's a mask I made. And that mask was blue copy. So it was a copy of the blue channel and pushed the black values up a little bit. But the idea is between this and it's in a layer group. Whoop, turn this off again. Between this mask and this mask, it's just affecting her hair. It's just trying to bring out a little bit of highlights in her hair.
Okay.
This is adding some shaping. So this is a burning, and again, it's a hue saturation. Saturation pulled down around 40%. The opacity of this is just 30%. Darken this area a little bit, darken this area a little bit in here. You know, just the idea to bring more light under her face. Another one, a little more of a boost here. Roll that over.
Going to that old Hollywood portrait look.
Exactly. Yeah, I really like the lighting Scott used on this. He was inspired by George Harrell's lighting style.
She looks so much like Elizabeth Taylor. It's scary.
Well, that was the whole idea for this. I called it homage to Liz for that, because that was exactly the idea with this.
Did you do a move to give her violet eyes?
Did we?
That was the deal with Elizabeth Taylor, supposedly the only woman with violet eyes.
Brightened her eyes there. It looks like it added a little bit of blue
there to
the irises. Yeah, yep. Added a little bit of blue Yeah, it's just a little hint. Actually, I had to do some research, and look through different images on Google for like what color were her eyes, and so here it was just like it was just adding a little bit. I don't know if it's that apparent or it turned on and off. So I'm not using any blending mode for it. So this is just a normal blending, but yeah, actually the only adjustment here you can see is adding a little bit of blue.
Very, very
So
cool.
that's how we're using blending modes in beauty retouching. Is that? And then here's something else that I see we're a little past the hour mark. So here's something
Oh, that's
else
fine.
that
I want to remind everybody that if you've got any general questions for the end of the show, go ahead and start typing them in now.
So this is a more straight product shoot. This was done with Hunter Freeman about a year ago. I think it was either late last fall. This was some stuff from Motorola, and the idea with this was all these props had to be movable. So he shot one of the things that I always emphasize with photographers: shoot a blank plate, a blank background for this. So then when he shot that and then he shot all the props in place, I could mask out the props and if need be, we can move this notebook around. So they actually had us moving it around, like, okay, here's a square thing, we need to move it over here for the vertical, for the whatever. So I had to move that around. But where I made the most heavy use of adjustment layers here, or a blending modes here, was in capturing the shadows. So if we take this image here, and I'm going to duplicate this layer, not delete, duplicate layer. I'm going to duplicate the layer. You see, this is basically just a shot of the thing with the cat with the layer captured in, or with the shadow captured into it. So I'm just trying to capture the shadow only. And then there's a layer mask on it, which gets rid of all these extraneous things. It kind of softens it up. I wanted this to be very soft so that it would blend in. So you wouldn't see a hard edge. So a soft edge here for that. And then here's the trick. And again, I learned this from the same person who taught me about the hue saturation thing. Her name's Carolyn Winslow. Here's the trick with this. You put this on multiply blending. So this is making it darker, and then this is what the thing looks like, and then I added adjustment layers to lighten it up to where.
Oh, okay.
So what I'm doing with this is, if we turn these layers on, you see that's what the goal here is. Is with this I am forcing this way to white, so the area that's outside of our shadow goes to white. Sometimes you have to boost the shadow up a little bit. I desaturated this with this curve, this color curves, pull the white point all the way down so it wouldn't have any effect on color. I could give it color this way. I could bring this up and give it a hint of color if I thought it needed that. And then this retouch here was when you push the contrast and stuff so strongly this way. The retouch thing sometimes, oh, that's what we're doing. We're getting rid of the seam. So it's just a layer to get rid of the seam. So if you know where to look, I see a little bit of a smudgy thing here for it, but that was, so hard to see and you had to know
Sure.
what to look for. It didn't cause a problem. But that's how we're adding the shadow into here. So I'm not having to paint a shadow, I'm not having to recreate a shadow. It's the actual photographic shadow
That's clever. I
being
like
added.
that.
And so each of these things got that as well. The nuts and the napkin. This layer down here is the shadow layer.
Can you just duplicate the adjustment layers that you did on the notebook, or does that each one re require its own specific one depending on the original?
It was sort of like I copied the original ones I did. I copied those. That's why they say copy. And then if I needed to make any other adjustments to them, I can make adjustments to
Okay,
them.
so you can start with a copy, but you might have to tweak it a little bit.
Right. Now the other thing that was really interesting is this one here. the glass, capturing this in required a little bit of tweaking around, because the shadow, the actual shadow for this, captured some of this light coming through the glass and some color for that. So what I had to do with that was, I got this working. By the time the color curves, you see I didn't pull all the color out of it. And with here, I'm also masking out the color curves. Mm-hmm. So I'm bringing some of that color back in. You see the difference here? This is what the mask is doing.
Right.
So I'm bringing some of that warm color back in there, but it wasn't quite enough. So I sampled the color and painted with soft light. And that's what this is, just adding a little bit more glow, a little more light coming in from there.
So the shadow is the real shadow, but the color is not the real color.
Right. But the whole idea with this is you're turning it on and off, see how closely am I matching up to what I'm doing. So, but this would have been really difficult to do without any blending modes, because, again, this had to be movable around. Sometimes you want it up here, sometimes you want it down here. The one trick is, you see there's texture in here. So if you move it to a place, it's like out here, they didn't have the texture, it might look a little odd. In that case, you might have to blur your layer for that. But for the most part, where it was winding up, in areas where it was pretty close, so I didn't have to worry that much about it.
Okay.
So let's see. What else do we want to show? I think we got time for maybe one more.
Got one more, and plus I know you have a handout that you prepared for us today.
Oh, yes. Yes. Here's another shot that's compositing. And this one here, this was done with a photographer, Gil Cope, and he directs commercials and also shoots advertising images. So this was for the rollout of Boeing 787, one of a series of images we did for this. And the whole idea with this was, he couldn't shoot the people inside the actual plane because the plane was too small to put the lights and all that in.
787 is too small?
Well, if you want to get a light for this guy, like if you're shooting an actual plane, can you imagine how high your light stand is going to be?
Okay, all right.
So what Gil did was he photographed the empty plane inside the plane, and then with the same camera angle, the same camera lens and all that, he set it up in the studio. And he used sheets of foam core or something like that here to kind of figure out where the walls were.
Sure.
And they had the actual seats from Boeing that they were featuring. I've never been in a plane that had these kind of seats, but I understand they're in first class. So
that's good. Never seen them.
Yeah, they look like really great seats for this. We had to composite all these different people, and I think we talked about this shot in the compositing thing. But you see there's all these different blending modes being used with this. So this one here is on screen blending mode, and it's just providing some light, some flare in the window, so it looks like there's actually glass in there.
Surface, yeah.
Because otherwise it looks like there's just holes in there.
Right.
And nobody wants to fly in a plane
with holes,
50,000
yes.
feet. You don't want to have a hole in the window.
They figured that out real early, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. This is using multiply blending, and it's adding shadowing. Easy way to add shadowing. This is using a blue color, a blue paint, and this is on multiply blending.
Okay.
But it's adding some density in there, and not only is it adding density, it's adding some more blue.
This is the first time in today's examples we've seen you paint with color on one of these blend layers.
Yeah, and in that case, it's like, we really need to make, this blue is cool, but we need to bump it up and make it look more dramatic for this. So that's kind of what all these different things are doing in here. And once you figure out, it worked here, you're like, hey, look, I can do the same thing over here.
Okay.
So bring more light into there, and this is a turquoise light. So that's here. It's bringing, looking like there's a fluorescent light or something in there, adding more glow into there.
Okay.
So it's just working on things like that. little curtain here, but that's what this thing is doing. And you can, I think it's hidden by most of the stuff. By the time we got the seats and stuff, that turned out to not be needed. And so you see, you know, all these different parts here are using different kinds of blending modes.
What is that? You've got a layer up towards the top that's just orange. What the heck is that?
This is on soft light blending, and it's just solid orange. Let's put the opacity to 100%. It's just solid orange. But the idea with that was the photographer was had this idea, and it's like he's used to thinking of photographic filters where you put a color filter in front of the lens.
Sure.
Like, oh, I'd like, you know, how about if we warm this up a little bit? And like, it was like this, like, hey, that looks great. So we put on soft light blending, so it's adding, you know, it's having a little bit of a lightening effect. It's mostly just adding, it's also mostly adding color into it.
Now, do you ever use the photo filter adjustment layer?
On occasion, but it's not one that naturally occurs to me. I'm not thinking
okay.
of that.
Okay.
And part of that is, you know, if you get really good at one particular technique, that tends to be your go-to
sure.
technique simply because you're so well-versed in it.
And thank goodness.
I know people that use the photo filter stuff a lot, but
that's how I get so many different show topics, because everybody has a different way of doing things.
Right. And then this final layer here is adding a lot of drama into it, and it's a curved layer set for multiply blending. We slow the opacity down by experiment to like 65%. You can see there's no adjustment going on in here, but there's a layer mask which is hiding, you know, brushing it out of the areas we didn't want to get too dark. So if I turn this on and then turn this off, you see she's getting too dark there, he's getting too dark. So it's just, and this is. Doesn't have to be a clean mask. This could be a pretty sloppy mask. We're just going through and painting, and removing out. And then here's our noise layer. And you see, in keeping with naming files, naming layers and stuff, you know, even though it's a noise pattern here, this also has the name of, you know, the amount of it in here.
Okay.
Since I lowered the scale of the image down, I might need to. You know,
rename it.
Get the same effect. I may need to add less noise because the scale, you know, the image is so much smaller than the original. But that's how that's constructed.
Excellent.
You mentioned the PDF. This is a PDF I wrote up some time ago. But this goes into detail. This is back in CS5, so you can see how old it is. But the same blending modes and the same effects work the same way.
This is more about the blending modes themselves and what they do rather than any sort of practical technique.
Exactly. Exactly. This one here shows about using the difference blending mode. I don't know if you want me to show that one now, but it's something I use a lot in compositing things. So if you want me to hit that, I can show that.
Give it one second here. I'm going to try a new feature for this webinar software. I've never tried it before, so it might not work, but I'm going to try to upload that PDF right now so that the audience viewing right now can download it. They should see a little panel over in their webinar dashboard that says handouts, and there should be a link now to this PDF called Blending Modes PDF. I will also, if that doesn't work, and please let me know if it does or doesn't, because if this could be very, very handy for a lot of future shows if it does turn out to work. If it doesn't work, I've already uploaded it to the forum thread for today's show. I'm pasting that link in right now. Plus, if you forget about it or lose it or whatever, it'll be up there for posterity. And if you've got any further questions or discussions about today's show, you can also continue the conversation over there. So far, it looks like it's working for most people. Again, there's a new little panel that's never existed before. It's called Handouts. It's over there next to the questions panel and all that. You might need to, click on the little arrow or the little plus sign to see it. It looks like it's working for 95% of the people. Marvelous, marvelous, marvelous. This is something that, like I say, it's brand new, but we might end up exploiting in future shows. Now, do you have further stuff that you want to... Now, you talk about difference mode.
Yeah, let's let's quickly touch on the difference mode thing. In fact, here in the article, I talk about this. So with difference blending, the way I use difference blending mode, I can close up this window and I can close that window. The way I use difference blending mode a lot is when I am compositing images together. If I need to make sure two layers are lining up exactly, mm-hmm. When I'm working on a movie poster or something where a designer has done a rough comp, so he does it in a lower resolution and then gives me this layered file, and I have to scale it up to the whatever the size they want and replace everything with high-res clean images and then go through and clean it up, I use this a lot. In the book I'm working on with Katrine Eisman, the update for Photoshop restoration and retouching, mm-hmm. One of the things talking about is removing distractions from the background. So, like I said, we're showing the phone on the thing with the notebook and the glass with all the shadow layers.
Right.
One of the things I recommend a lot is photographers shoot blank backgrounds. So, in this one case, a photographer was on the streets of San Francisco shooting a man in a suit as an advertisement for the suit maker, and there are people walking in the background all the time. So in between, while the guy's getting dressed, he's like, hey, there's nobody in the background now. He takes several shots of the background with nobody walking through the scene, and then he's got that he can place into the scene and cover up the people walking it. So the difference blending mode is used a lot for that. So I'm just going to show it here. I've copied the layer of my daughter and just kind of pulled it way over here. If I want to make sure these two things line up perfectly, suppose I'd copy that over. Let's turn these off. Suppose I'd just brought this in from something else. I want to make sure these two things line up.
Mm-hmm.
If I set this to difference blending mode, wherever the images, the two layers are exactly the same, we'll turn to black.
Mm-hmm.
And wherever they're different, you get this kind of a rainbowy kind of effect. So now I can move this around and kind of nudge it up or down.
Use the arrow keys, get folks. That's
use,
the best.
Use
way.
The arrow keys, zoom in, and
boom.
When they're lined up, it turns black. Now, if I turn this back to normal, turn on off, you see it's lined up perfectly.
Now, in theory, we would be compositing two, at least slightly different things. It's very unusual to be compositing the exact same item on top of itself. So you'll be looking to get as close to black as you can, but it might not turn completely black.
Right. Typically, if you're replacing like a low resolution one or something that's been slightly blurred or whatever, and you want a sharper version, for whatever reason, typically you see like little bits of outline. But you see where, okay, I've got almost everything lined up. And typically what I do is when I'm lining that up is like, if I have to scale it with free transform,
mm-hmm.
I'll like, okay, this little bit here, that's easily identifiable.
There you go.
And it's close to one edge, so I can, if I get something up in this area here to line up and something in this area to line up, then I know I've got them far apart. If I do it like really close here, the error down here could be greater. So I look to go as far apart as possible and line up one identifying characteristic, put the little X mark there for the free transform, and then scale it and line up the other one.
Yeah, this is the one technique you've shown today that I use the most. I use it particularly like whenever I'm rotating things and along those lines. And this is an invaluable tip.
Now, the other thing that I recommend a lot is let's duplicate this to a new layer, a new document. And let's just save this as a JPEG. Save as. Come on.
You're making it
work. Love the bouncing beach ball. Anyway, the idea is save this as a JPEG. The idea with this is put it in here. I'm going to leave it as untitled. Save as JPEG, and we're going to crunch it a whole lot.
Mm.
Okay, so we just crunched it a whole lot. Close that. And now I'm going to come up here and open recent, and oh, it's not going to show up in open recent.
Right,
okay, so
open it, yeah.
We come back over to here, and it should be down here. We open this up in Photoshop and turn off this. We can take our image there. Now I'm going to drag this on top of this one here. And so this is our JPEG version. This is our un-JPEG version. If I set this to difference blending, you can start to see where all the JPEG artifacts are.
There you go. That's what I was saying, that sometimes you'll never get it completely black. And I want to point out that you only turn it, you only turn the one you're trying to match to difference. The other one remains whatever. Well, it's going to have to be normal, otherwise this isn't going to
right.
work well.
Right, but if you want to evaluate just how much loss you're getting with JPEG, this is the technique I recommend. And most of the time, we crunch this a lot, so we really exaggerate the difference. It becomes really pretty obvious here. But most of the time, it's pretty slight. So in that case, what I'll do is clip a curve adjustment layer to it, and then just push the white values all the way, or not you know, clip it to that, sorry. And then you push the white values all the way over, and you exaggerate those differences. Like, okay, I see lots of stuff going on over here.
Okay.
Turn this off, put it to normal. And then now you know where to look, and you kind of turn it on and off, Then you turn it on and off and see. And you know, with this, it should be pretty obvious because we crunched it up a whole lot, but that's what the JPEG artifacting looks like.
Excellent.
That's a way of double-checking, like, how much am I losing if I save it on JPEG 10 or if I save it on JPEG 6? Well, you can do that with the exact file and know exactly what you're losing.
Marvelous. Marvelous. Well, excellent. You've got a new website you're real excited about.
Yes. An update to my website. It's still dunbardigital.com, you see here. But now it's a brand spanking new WordPress website. Got my portfolios in here. Got a cool before-after thing here. This is one of the reasons why I went to WordPress is we could actually come up with this where you can slide the slider back and forth and see what the before or after of the thing looks like.
These look familiar.
Yeah. And you can see here, like, that's how sharp the background was. And then we turn the background into here. So there's all kinds of cool features in here. I have my blog. And one of the things I'm doing with these days is I'm doing a series of interviews with clients for high-end retouching. To the idea of getting their perspective on what's important to them about high-end retouching. So this one, it was with photographer Hunter Freeman, and I'm trying to do them about once a month.
Mm-hmm.
But they're interviews with art buyers, art directors, advertising photographers, anybody I can find on the client side. And the whole idea is to ask them a series of questions and get their feedback on exactly what's important to them.
So it's kind of like
RetouchPRO
Live, and only instead of interviewing the retoucher to find out their point of view for other retouchers, you're interviewing the other direction, the agency, and things along those lines.
Exactly. I thought there's lots of stuff, and your site's a good one for people who want to learn how to be a retoucher. But one of the things I noticed was, like, you know, it can be kind of like a circular conversation. We all talk to each other, but the real thing is what matters to the people who are going to hire us.
Marvelous.
So let's cover that. So there's all that stuff in my blog. You can also, or on my website, you can email me here, either click here or do this. But check out my website, and feel free to email me if you have any questions. The email is dennis@dunbardigital.com.
And you've got a new book coming out.
Yes. It's going to come out, I think, at the end of the year, beginning of next year. It's an update for Katrine Eisman's Photoshop Restoration and Retouching.
Mm-hmm.
Katrine invited me to work with her and Wayne Palmer on co-authoring the new update for it, and we're in the thick of the writing side of it now.
This will be what, the fourth edition?
Yes, it's going to be the fourth edition. Yes, fourth edition of it. So So, my first foray into book writing, and very excited.
And we're all excited for
Katrine's
you.
been especially great to work with.
Marvelous, marvelous. Well, okay. If you any final thoughts?
Go out and practice.
There you go.
All this stuff you learn, all the stuff you hear, doesn't really become concrete in your mind until you practice it.
That's the difference between Dennis and you is practice. Forget all that blasted art theory and technique and all that. It's practice.
Well, to a large extent, it kind of does come down to that.
Yeah. It's a hard truth. It really is. All right. Well, I wonder.
Me and Michael Jordan is just practice on the basketball court, right?
Yeah, forget about being 7'2" or whatever. Let's see. I want to remind everybody about the forum thread for the show. I'm repasting that link in right now. We've got the PDF up there, and you can also ask further questions or give further feedback, further ideas for future shows, things along those lines. Remind everybody about our playlist for Dennis's previous shows. Some of the images that he showed us today, we went into much greater detail talking about everything except the blending modes. I've just pasted in the playlist link there, and I found from previous shows that some people can't use the playlist links. So I will also paste in the general Retouch Pro YouTube channel link there. Much simpler, youtube.com/retouchpro. And you can see all of our previous shows with Dennis, along with all of our previous shows with everyone else there as well. And I'll just go ahead and paste in that link to our video rental site, too, if you want to check out the calculation show with Chris Tarantino. We've also got a lot of other beauty stuff up there as well. You might want to check that out. And a reminder, hopefully a gentle reminder, but a firm and important reminder, that if you like Retouch Pro Live, if you want to see Retouch Pro Live continue, the only way you can guarantee that is to help by becoming a patron. I'm pasting the patron link, retouchpro.com/patron, in right now. You will need to register to become a patron, but like I say, you want to register anyway to make sure that you get invited to all of the future live shows. All right. Well, thank you to everyone for showing up today. Thanks for all the excellent questions and comments, and thanks for all the feedback and letting me know that the PDF downloaded correctly. There'll be a little survey that pops up after the show. There's a blank field at the end of that if you want to type in your ideas for future shows with Dennis, or perhaps in completely other areas. That's okay, too. That's where I get a lot of my best ideas for shows. So don't forget that. If you're watching this on YouTube, just type it into the comments field. All right. Well, again, thanks to everybody for showing up, especially thanks to Dennis Dunbar, and I will see you in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Dennis.
Goodbye.